Our first task is to look at the CPS and look at the various fields within the CPS. So the radio's code plug is divided into a number of trees, and there you can see are the various trees. Let's go through those slowly. The first one is radio information. This displays some information relating to the radio itself. So if you read a radio with the CPS, you open this window and it will display some information related to that radio. This includes the serial number, the model number, the code plug version, the software version, otherwise known as the firmware version, the frequency range, the power, any option board, and a short description of the radio itself. Now you'll notice that when you put the mouse cursor over any of those fields, it changes and it shows a pair of spectacles. This tells you that that field is read-only. So there's no information here which can be edited. The next one that we have is per radio. So in here are all the settings relating to per radio. We can say that in fact these are the global settings. So if I click on this symbol over here, this connector, this plus sign here, what it will do is it will expand all the information contained within it. So there are a number of sub-windows or sub-menus. The first thing we come across here is button definition. So if we double-click on it, it brings up the window and it shows us information relating to the buttons on the radio. So there are four programmable buttons on this particular model of radio. This happens to be a GP380. So we have the button on the top, side button 1, side button 2, and side button 3. Remember that the PTT over here is not configurable. It's fixed. It's defined as PTT. The same applies to the buttons on the front. These buttons here are pretty much not configurable to particular functions. Next up, alerts. Here we would configure all the alerts available to us on the radio. You'll notice that it consists of a number of tabs. So the first three relate to the alerts. The fourth one relates to the volume, so the alert volume. And the last one relates to the buttons. So you can disable the alert on that particular button when the function is activated. The next window is miscellaneous. So here you will find that there are a number of features available, or a number of configurations available here, a lot of settings, and they relate to a number of aspects of the operation of the radio. Let's go through these slowly. The first one is language. So what is the, let's say, prompt language on the radio? Remember that this particular model is a display model, so this field is not grayed out. If it was a non-display model, that field would be grayed out. You would not be able to change it. So the types of languages supported are listed here. And then the next field is the option board. What type of option board is installed on the radio? There are a number of options available to you. And the vendor of the option board will tell you what type of setting to put here in their instructions. RX audio accessory connector. Because this is a portable radio, this field is grayed out. Radio ID. Now, in code plug version 6 and onwards, the radio supports a feature called radio ID or user ID. Now, what you can do is when the radio switches on, the user can enter in a user ID number. So this would be a number which is allocated to them. If they don't enter a user number, then that user ID will be set to a particular default value. So what is the default value? You specify it over here. Okay, so these are what we call the U1 to U8 variable digits. Now don't worry too much about this information. When we come to the programming exercises, we'll learn a lot more about it. Handset audio, that's available on the mobile. Ignition sense, available on the mobile. Ignition override, also available on the mobile. Single status list, if you put a tick there, what the radio will do is it will use a status list for both encode and decode. So we'll get to see this when we do a practical exercise with status. Test mode disable. This is a feature which is only available on the mobile radio, and what it does is it prevents the user accessing test mode accidentally. Okay, so you can go in and you can press the button by mistake and it will go into test mode. Okay, it's very difficult to get there, but you can have the ability to disable access to the test mode. FastVote scan start RSSI level. So this relates to a feature of the radio called vote scanning. And what we can do is we can have the radio scan for a channel, but not only scan for a channel, scan for the strongest channel, the channel which has the strongest signal. And the way we do that is by means of these two settings here. So FastVote RSSI level, the radio will stop on a channel, or it will regard a channel as being active or tagged if the RSSI level goes above minus 75 dBm. If the signal drops below minus 85 dBm, the radio will start to scan again, because obviously that channel, the signal strength has gone too low. Now, of course, we've got minus 75 and minus 85 here. You can go change that and from minus 120 to minus 70 dBm. Okay, so that level is fairly accurate. Moving on, display and keypad. Because the radio has a display, we can specify a message to display when the radio switches on. So while when the radio switches on, this message will be shown on the screen for a period of about 2 seconds. So you can put any text in there if you want, or if you want, you can enter, let's say, non-Roman characters. And what we mean by this is these characters. So if you see at the bottom here, there's a little button, show keyboard. So if you want, you can enter some Cyrillic characters and so forth. We'll have to take that out. All right, default radio display. So by default, the radio will display the current selected channel. You can change this, you can make it a default text message. If you put a default text message, you have to specify something here. Okay, normally you will leave it as a channel. Keypad enabled. Do you want to enable the keypad? Yes. And if you enable the keypad, if anyone presses the number buttons on the keypad, what should it do? It should enter the address. It should enter the ID of a radio which we want to call, or whatever. Prefix. Because the radio has a display, if we select a particular channel, the radio will display CHAN colon space and the channel number. So if the radio is on channel 1, the radio will display on the display CHAN colon space 1. Now you can edit this, you can change it. Again, you can enter non-Roman characters in any of these fields here. If you go into the menu function called contact list, and you select a particular name from the contact list, when you go in there, you will see ADDR colon space and the name. So in our practical exercises, you'll see that I'll tell you to take this away. Remember that if you put that in that field. If you go into the contact list, remember that that stuff there takes up 6 characters on the display, and the display is only 14 characters. So if you take it away, it gives you an additional 6 characters to put to the contact list entry. The same thing applies here. So if you go into the status list, the status encode list, the radio will show STAT colon space and the status name, the status alias. Memory and power up channels. Here what we can do is we can specify that when the radio switches on, it should go to a particular channel, a designated power up channel. You can also specify 2 memory channels, and these would be accessed by pressing the buttons on the side of the radio. So there is a memory channel 1 and memory channel 2. Next, timers, TX timeout timer. I don't think that needs much explanation. Call answer time. So if you have the radio and we use selective call, we'll get an exercise with that, and we set the radio to ring when it receives a selective call, then you can specify the amount of time the user has to answer the call. Backlight mode. How should the display backlight work? You can either have it enabled, disabled, or timed. Okay, and there is a certain time that the radio will keep the backlight on. I believe it's 10 seconds. Lone worker response time, lone worker reminder time. These are two settings relating to the feature of the radio called lone worker. We'll get an exercise with it. Basically, the way lone worker works is that we'll have the radio will operate as normal for a certain period. After a certain time, in this case 10 minutes, the radio will start to sound an alert, and it will continue to sound an alert for, in this case, 10 seconds, although you can, and you probably want to change that, but the radio will sound an alert for that period, the lone worker reminder time. And if the user of the radio does not respond to that by pressing a button or doing something, then the radio will enter emergency mode. And we can do certain things in emergency mode. We can send a telegram to the control room radio, for example, to indicate that this particular user has an emergency situation and so forth. Smart PTT periodic time. This is the time that the user must press the PTT button and talk before a PTT ID is sent. Now, this only works if the smart PTT function is enabled in the CPS. If it's disabled, it won't do anything. So smart PTT, the way that it works is if someone presses the PTT and they press the PTT for longer, in this case 30 seconds, the radio will send a PTT ID. So it's quite a useful feature in that we don't have to send the PTT ID every transmission. We only need to do that if the transmission is longer than 30 seconds. Moving on, microphone. So there are some microphone gain settings. So we've got mic gain external and internal. So internal refers to the microphone inside the radio. If it was a mobile radio, internal microphone would refer to the fist mic connected to the RJ45 connector on the front of the radio. The external microphone on the portable refers to a RSM or a headset. And on the mobile radio, a external microphone refers to the microphone connected on the accessory connector on the back. So on the back of the mobile radio, you'll see there's a 20-pin accessory connector. One of those pins is assigned to microphone input, and the gain for that microphone input is set here. Right, on the portable radio, there is a feature called whisper mode, and it's particularly useful for your sort of police type application where you would want to have the ability to increase the microphone gain. So picture it, you have a policeman and he's doing some surveillance work, he's following someone in the forest or something like that, and he doesn't want to talk on the radio in a normal voice like I'm doing now. He wants to whisper on the radio, so he presses this button, this whisper mode button, it switches the feature on, and he can whisper into the microphone of the radio, and the users at the other end can hear him quite clearly. On the portable radio we have Vox. So Vox is voice operated transmit, and what it does is whenever the user speaks into the microphone, the radio will automatically transmit. Now this feature is only available on the portable radio if you connect a accessory in, so for example an RSM or a headset. Battery alerts, RX low battery alert, TX low battery alert. By default you'd want to leave these things on, although you can turn them off. So that there is the miscellaneous settings. So you can see that there are a number of different types of settings available to you here. The next up is signaling definition. Multi-call user mode. There are two options here, basic user and advanced user. 99.9% of the time you will use basic user. Advanced user is if you want to become quite fancy with Select 5 signaling. So for most cases you'd want to use basic user. Authorization request button function. So in Select 5, in this particular radio, we have a feature called authorization. What you can do is you can have that before the user is granted access to the radio channel, they have to send an authorization request. So the authorization request will typically go off to the control room radio. The control room radio will decode this Select 5 call and send an acknowledgement back, which would be the authorization. The authorization response. And when the radio receives that, then the radio can go ahead and speak on the channel. So there are some particular applications where you'd want to use that. Sequence timeout in terms of milliseconds. So how long will the radio wait for a particular sequence? Okay, here you can specify 260 milliseconds. These sort of fields you would not want to change. Okay, for unless you there is a specific need, you'd leave it as it is. Acknowledge expected duration. So let's say we have a selective call and we call radio 2. So let picture in your mind radio 1 and radio 2. So when radio 1 calls radio 2, then radio 2 will send back an acknowledge. And if the radio 2 does not send an acknowledge within 5 seconds, then radio 1 will display call failed. It will give an error tone. Cumulative TX timeout reset duration. So the timeout timer on the radio operates in two modes. It's cumulative or non-cumulative. Now cumulative means that your, let's say, timeout time seconds add up as you talk. With non-cumulative, you talk, you listen, you talk, you listen, and that timeout timer never adds up. Now you can specify a timeout. If you use cumulative TX timeout timer, then you can specify how many seconds the user can, let's say, listen. Okay, let's say he transmits and then he receives, and he transmits and then he receives, and he adds up his 60 seconds, and the radio can't transmit anymore. So if he waits, and you can see the setting here, 10 seconds. If he waits 10 seconds, then his cumulative timeout timer resets back to zero, and he can carry on talking. Okay. So there are some applications where you'd want to use that. It's a really nice setting to prevent one particular user hogging the channel. Carrier gone time. So how long should the radio wait for the carrier to come back? So the radio, if the carrier disappears, the radio will wait 0 seconds before regarding the carrier as being gone, as disappeared. So this is particularly used in community repeater applications. Telegram repeat, how many times should it repeat a particular telegram? By default, you'd leave it as one. Missed call list. If the radio has a display, we can have that the radio, when it receives a call and the user doesn't answer, that call goes into a missed call list. There are 10 entries in the call list, and it works on pretty much FIFO. So as a radio call is received, it will display the user who called. Okay, so it's like a missed call, like very much like in a cell phone. Voice storage. So the way this works is you can record a voice message on the radio, but remember that this feature requires a voice storage option board. Okay, the radio doesn't come standard with this feature, so you need to install this option board before you can use voice storage. So looking at this whole window here, probably the only thing that you would want to change, and the only thing that we'll probably change in our exercises, is this field here, acknowledge expected duration. It's probably the only one that you want to change here. The other one that you might also want to change is missed call list. Looking at the next one, menu item. Because this radio has a display, we can have access to the menu. And in here, you would specify what are the menu functions you want to give the user access to. So you may want to give them access to the contact list, the missed call list, and perhaps radio ID. And then under the utilities menu, what functions you want to give them access to, maybe things like power level, perhaps turning off the backlight, and maybe scan or something like that. So if there is no tick next to the menu function, then the user will not have any access to it. If the radio was a non-display radio, you would not be able to open this window. Okay, you would not be able to open this window. Moving on. RF. So under here we have two tabs, TX and RX. So here are some settings relating to TX. Rekey inhibit duration. So if the radio, the timeout timer expires and the user tries to, let's say, bypass it by letting go of the PTT for half a second and retransmit, then transmitting again, here you can say, right, well, the radio is inhibited from rekeying for a period of so many seconds. So here it's set to zero. So if the user presses the PTT, they let go, they transmit again, the radio will beep, so they have to wait 3 seconds before they can start transmit again. Okay. So again, it's another nice feature to prevent particularly is the amount of time that the radio must be keyed up in order for the radio to send the PTT key up encode. Minimum key up. Same thing here. So how long must the radio be transmitting before the radio will send the PTT ID? Oh, okay. This one's opposite. Okay, let me do this again. Take three. Periodic telegram repeat time. So this is how long the radio must be receiving before it will regard... Well, let me do that. Let me rephrase that. Periodic telegram repeat time is the amount of time the radio must be receiving before the telegram is repeated. Minimum key up for telegram repeat is the amount of time the radio must transmit before it will repeat the PTT encode telegram. Per radio, RF RX, auto reset time, very important function. So auto reset, basically the way that it works is the radio receives a selective call, it moves from tone squelch, in other words the speaker is closed, to carrier squelch, in other words the speaker is, let's say, open, and the speaker will stay open for a particular amount of time. We call this the auto reset time. Okay, and you can define how that auto reset time works by another feature which will come to called, or another setting which will come to called the auto reset mode. External alarm, hook type, all of these things are available on the mobile radio. Authorization request monitor time. We spoke earlier about authorization request. So how long will the radio wait before it regards that there was no authorization response received? Okay, moving on to scan. So scan works pretty much like it does in all other radios. So we have a scan list, and we can specify the number of entries in the scan list. So there would be all the channels. As you can see, they're all set to 1. If you had more channels, you would change those fields there. In terms of options, there are a number of ways the radio can scan. So if the radio is scanning and the user presses the PTT, what should happen? Well, the radio should transmit on the start channel. That means the channel on which the radio was before the scan button was pressed. On the designated channel, on a particular predefined channel, the last free channel, the last busy channel, or on the voted channel. Now, we spoke about vote scanning. Basically, the radio can scan, but it can also scan for the strongest signal. So if the user presses the PTT, the radio should transmit on the channel which has the strongest signal. Hang time, so the radio stops on a particular channel and it should monitor the channel for that time there, 3 seconds. Sweep time, how long should the radio scan through the scan list? So there you can see it's set to 0, although really the radio can't scan through the channels in 0 seconds. It takes the radio probably about, I would say probably about 100 milliseconds to scan through 8 channels properly. So it's not truly 0, but it is as close as possible to 0. Priority channel. What is the priority channel? So you can specify a priority channel, and the radio will go back and check that channel on a regular basis. Switches. So there are some settings, other settings relating to scan. Talkback enable. So if the radio is scanning and it stops on a particular channel, when the user presses the PTT, it should go back on. They should talk back or transmit on the channel which the radio landed on. Carrier squelch only. Should the radio, when it's scanning, only look at carrier squelch as a condition? If there is no tick, then the radio will scan not only for carrier, but for the signaling parameters which you specify in the channel or in the personality. Include current channel when the radio is scanning. Should it also scan the current channel? Nuisance reset. Should you give the user access to nuisance delete and nuisance reset? Auto acknowledge and scan. This is a feature relating to select 5. And when the radio is scanning, should the radio be allowed to send and auto acknowledge? Scan LED, leave that as ticked. What that does is when the radio is scanning, the LED on the top of the radio will flash green. Vote enable, this works with vote scanning, so you would put a tick there if you are using vote scan. Now, this particular window here, scan, has something slightly different about it. At the bottom, you've got a small toolbar. And the toolbar allows you to do certain things. For example, if I click on this green plus sign over here, what it will do is it will add another scan list. Now that I've added another scan list, I can navigate through the scan list by pressing these buttons at the bottom. I can also display the scan list rather than a window. I can display the scan list as a table. So I can go into table view rather than window view. To go back, It's like that. If I click on the red cross, that will delete that entry. Okay, so all of these windows which have let's say multiples, so for example like scan per channel, per personality, all of those things, you can have multiples of them, and those ones which have that have got this toolbar at the bottom. Right, moving on, emergency. Some settings relating to emergency. So we can access emergency by pressing the emergency button on the radio, or by not responding to the lone worker alert. And when the radio goes into emergency mode, we can make the radio do certain things. For example, emergency squelch, set as speaker closed. So the squelch mode, when the radio is in emergency, will be speaker closed. In other words, no audio comes through onto the speaker. There are other options, PL squelch or carrier squelch. On or switch enable. If the radio is in emergency mode, we can disable the on or switch by not ticking that field there. Secret emergency enable. If we put a tick there, what the radio will do is it will disable all the alerts. Emergency revert channel. We can specify a dedicated channel for emergency. And you can even specify a channel which is not available to the user to select from the knob. So you can have a secret, let's say a secret emergency channel, a separate emergency channel which is only used for emergencies on the radio. Emergency encode telegram. So when the radio goes into emergency mode, what telegram should be sent to indicate emergency? You can specify a telegram there. Emergency 2 tab. So emergency microphone gain. When the radio is in emergency mode, how much extra gain should we have on the microphone? And you can see that there are two settings there, internal and external. So what happens is when the radio goes into emergency mode, it adds on an extra 6 dB to the existing microphone gain. And you can change it. You can go all the way up to 45 dB. Emergency cycles mode. As you can see there, it's disabled. What you can do is you can say forever. So the radio goes into emergency mode and it will start to transmit. And then it will receive. It will transmit and it will receive. Okay, what we call emergency cycles. TX RX, and you can go into this loop and you can do that, well, forever. Okay, it's a very theoretical measure because the radio will do that forever, but it's not quite forever because we know that eventually the radio's PA will burn out or the battery will run flat. So take your pick, whichever happens first. Generally the battery. If we set that to forever, just remember that you need to program into the radio a decoder definition called emergency exit. Now we'll do this when we do a practical exercise. So moving on, if you've got a voice storage board in the radio, every time the radio transmits in emergency mode, it should send a pre-recorded voice message. Emergency switch debounce time. So if you specify the orange button on the top of the radio to be the emergency switch, in order for the user to activate the emergency, they have to press that button in for longer than 2000 milliseconds or 2 seconds. Emergency tone during TX, this field here. If the radio goes into emergency mode and you have users who don't have, let's say, display or they don't have select fire features on their radio, they can easily identify that this is an emergency signal because it has the emergency tone on it. And the emergency tone sounds like a faint, high-pitched beeping noise that goes on in the background. Okay, so if the users hear that beeping sound on a transmission, they know that this is an emergency. Emergency TX RX cycle time. So we said that emergency cycles mode, the radio will go transmit and then will receive, transmit and it will receive. So how long should it transmit for, and how long should it receive for? Okay. So here it's 10 seconds, there it's 10 seconds. So transmit for 10 seconds, receive for 10 seconds. GPIO lines. Now, if I try to open GPIO lines, what you will see is this. It's because this feature is not available on the portable radio. It's a mobile specific feature. Contact list, because the radio is a display and keypad radio, we have this feature called contact list. So in here you will put the name, and over here you would put the address, the number that you would use to call that particular radio. Of course, we can have a number of multiples of these, so we can click on the add button and we can create multiple entries in the contact list. The maximum, of course, is 255. Maximum is 255. Now, in one of the exercises, I'm going to show you how to create a contact list outside of the CPS, because it's quite nice, but it takes quite a while to do this sort of thing. We can create the contact list in Microsoft Excel. So in one of the exercises, I'm going to show you how to create that contact list in Excel. Look, there's nothing stopping you from doing it in the CPS, but we can do it in Excel. And because we can do it in Excel, we can farm this work off to perhaps the customer or to someone in our company who can do this. Like, I'm thinking of a secretary, although it could be anyone. Anyone who is good with Microsoft Excel can create the contact list. And in this exercise, one particular exercise, I will show you how we create that contact list. Right, status decode, status encode. These two work together. Now, they relate back to here. Let me show it to you again. You'll see this field, single status list. So if you select single status list, it will use the one status list for encoding and decoding. Let's have a look at status decode. So there you can see is the alias. So we can put in a name. Let's say on duty. And we can assign a number to on duty. So if the radio sends status 01, on the receiving radio, it will show on duty. Now, if we come to status encode, you will see that at the top here, it says something to us in red. If single status list is enabled, use only status decode. So if there is a tick here, if we tick that there, then we only need to use status decode. We don't need status encode. Okay. Configuration bytes. I'm going to show this to you, but do not change anything in this window. Do not change anything in this window. You can change it, but only do this under the instruction of a Motorola engineer. If you change anything here and you don't know what you're doing, you will cause the radio to stop working as designed. We can enter certain values in here to modify the operation of the radio slightly. Now, how will it modify the operation? If you go here, at the top of the toolbar, you'll see that there is this help button. You'll see it's a little question mark with an arrow. You click on it, and you click on any of these fields here. It will bring up the help file. Okay? And in here is a written description of those things. Okay, how the radio's operation will change if you input any values here. So I'll say it again, the third time. Do not change anything here. Right, that's per radio. Let's move on to per channel. So in here we have the settings relating to the channel. TX frequency, RX frequency. Now, both of these have got a reference frequency. And this reference frequency relates to the frequency used by the microprocessor for its clock. Now, In some situations, the harmonic of the microprocessor clock frequency might interfere with the receive frequency. So what we can do is we can change it from automatic to another value over here. By default, you'd leave it as automatic. So there are very, very specific situations where you would change the reference frequency. Channel spacing. So there are three options here, 12.5, 20, or 25 kilohertz. This would be defined on your license. Most countries use 12.5 kilohertz channel spacing. Some countries, and there is quite a few of them, still use 25 kilohertz channel spacing. So changing this field will change certain operating parameters of the radio. Most notably, the IF bandwidth for the receiver and the maximum deviation level for the transmitter. So there are particular values for the different channel spacing. Power level, so you can select high or low power. The factory default for low power is 1 watt, for high power is 4 watts. Because the radio has a display, we can specify a name for the channel. Otherwise, if you leave it out, it will display the number, so 1, for example. PL, DPL, so PL and DPL. So PL in a non-Motorola language is CTCSS, DPL, DCS. So you can specify whether the radio should have a PL or DPL tone on it. So if we specify PL, we can specify the PL code or the PL frequency. If we specify DPL, we can specify the DPL code. There is also inverted DPL. So this is ones. The actual PL code is sent as a ones complement. Okay, so the code is inverted. If you select PL, you can specify the PL code, or you can specify a custom encode PL frequency. Now be very careful about this, because most radios use standard PL codes. So we have a list of standard PL codes which we can use. So be careful about this feature. PL reverse burst to DPL turn off code. If you tick that, as I've done, what the radio will do is at the end of transmission, the radio will send the PL code but shifted by 120 degrees. By doing this, the receiving radio will mute, because it thinks that the PL code is invalid. And what that does, it has the effect, and this is particularly now on simplex, it has the effect of eliminating that crunch noise you hear at the end of the transmission. So just picture it. Someone is talking on the two-way radio. When they let the PTT go, you hear that like at the end of transmission. So if you enable this feature, it switches that noise off at the end of the transmission. Miscellaneous. So is this radio a member of a particular scan list? When the user goes to this channel, should the radio automatically start scanning? Repeater talk around. What this does is it gives the user the ability to bypass the repeater. So let's say there is a power failure, or there is a fault on the repeater, or the users go outside the coverage area of the repeater. They can go to their radio, they can press a button called repeat a talk around, what happens is it takes the receive frequency, sorry, it takes the transmit frequency, makes it equal to the receive frequency. So in other words, the radios are able to talk to each other on simplex. Inhibit repeater talk around. Do we want to disable repeater talk around access on this radio? Inhibit channel selection. So the channel is in the radio, but the user cannot select it. So we would use this, for example, like I've told you about emergency. So for example, you could disable access to that channel and have it dedicated. The next stop we have is personality, and like channels, we can have multiple personalities. The way personality works is that, let's say you have two channels in the radio, for example. Channel 1 can have personality 1, channel 2 can have personality 2. Now, channel 1 and 2 might have the same frequency, but the way channel 1 works and the way channel 2 works is quite different because of the personality. So let's look at the settings in that personality. TX admit criteria, under what conditions is the radio allowed to transmit? And there are a lot of settings over here. Okay, I'm not going to go through all of them because they get quite technical to explain. But what you can do is you can always go click on the help and click on the field, and it will show you a text describing each of the options. So the main ones I would think that you would use quite often is always allowed or channel free, or things like PL, DPL lockout. So this would be for your, let's say, community repeater. TX timer mode. So we spoke earlier about cumulative and non-cumulative. Do the seconds add up or not? Auto reset mode. How should the auto reset timer start counting? There are few options over here. Obviously disabled, carrier override, carrier independent or manual override. Carrier override means as long as there is activity on the channel, as long as there's carrier present on the channel, the auto reset timer will not start counting. Forced monitor mode. This is a feature particularly in the US where the users are required to monitor the channel before they can transmit. So you can specify how forced monitor mode works. Encode hold time, so how long after the telegram has been sent should the radio continue to transmit. Transmit admit criteria not applied in auto reset, so when the auto reset timer is counting, the transmit admit criteria over here should not be applied. Okay, obviously if you've got always allowed, it's always allowed. Busy channel lockout. As the name suggests, if the channel is busy, the user cannot transmit. Squelch, there are three settings over here. RX squelch mode, so when the radio is in its normal mode of operation, how should the squelch work? So there are a number of settings here. Carrier squelch, as we know, carrier opens the speaker. PL, DPL, PL or DPL opens the speaker. Tone squelch, now be very careful. Tone squelch refers to select 5 squelch. So in order to open the speaker, in order for audio to come through onto the speaker, we need to apply carrier plus a select 5 tone, and that select 5 tone has to be correct. PL, DPL and tone squelch, as the name suggests, PL plus select 5. Monitor 1 squelch mode, so if the user presses the monitor button once, the radio will move into monitor 1 squelch mode. What is that? Well, you can specify either carrier squelch or PL, DPL squelch. When the user changes the channel, what should the radio do? It should move back to RX squelch mode. Reverse squelch, so the operation, the logic of the squelch should be in reverse. Okay, so when the radio switches on, it should be in monitor 1 squelch mode. If the user presses the monitor button, then the radio should go into tone squelch mode. PL override. So the user should be able to override the PL condition on the RX squelch mode. miscellaneous? Should Vox be enabled on this personality? Should Whisper be enabled on this personality? Should the user be disallowed from selecting Whisper mode? Should the option board work on this personality? Should the user be disabled or disallowed from switching the option board on or off? Should Lone Worker be enabled? So if you put a tick next to Lone Worker, then Lone Worker will be enabled on this personality. Audio. Pre-emphasis, de-emphasis on voice. Pre-emphasis, de-emphasis on signaling. You'd want to leave these settings as they are. Okay, so pre-emphasis, de-emphasis. You will find out about the pre-emphasis and de-emphasis in the class, and you will always apply pre-emphasis and de-emphasis on the voice, but not on the signaling. Expand, low-level expansion. These are two noise reduction features available in the radio, and you will learn about these in the class, the way they actually work. And you can enable or disable these. Remember that they are mutually exclusive, so you can only have one, you can't have the other. You can also disallow the user from switching expand on or off. PTT. So when the user of the radio presses PTT, how should it send the Select 5 PTT ID? At the beginning of transmission or at the end of transmission? Select 5 in code. So on the side of the radio, we've got those three programmable buttons plus one orange button on the top. We can assign those buttons to either call 1, call 2, call 3, or call 4. And if we say side button 2 sends call 1, call 1 will send telegram 1. And we'll see what is telegram 1. What does it consist of? The same thing goes here. Call 2 will send telegram X. Call 3 will send telegram X, and so forth. Select 5 decode. So we have the ability to specify up to 16 decoder definitions, and we can enable or disable that particular decoder definition in this personality. Right, moving on to the Select 5. So under Select 5, we have encoder and decoder definitions. And under encoder definitions, we have encoder sequences and encoder telegrams. So if we go to encoder sequence, here we will specify the sequence the radio should send. Okay. So here are the numbers and the variable digits which the radio must send. Now we can send 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. A, B, C, D, E, F. So it's basically hexadecimal. Now, that sequence can be up to 12 characters long or 12 digits long. We can also specify variable digits, and this can be from, remember that if you put a variable digit, you have to put open brackets, variable digits, close brackets. That can be from A1 to A8. Or S1 to S3, or if you have your radio has code plug version 6 or later, U1 to U8. So if you're using address, you can go all the way up to A8. In our exercises, we'll probably only go up as far as A4. So you'll see that in the exercises, we use things like that. Okay. Like a personality, We can have multiple sequences. Okay, so you click on these buttons here to add or select, move forwards and move backwards. Then the telegrams is used to tie the sequences together. So we don't send sequences, we send telegrams. And in the telegram, we can specify what sequences to send. We can specify up to 3 sequences in a telegram. By default, you may only want to send 1, you might only want to send 2. It depends on what it is that you want to do. So we can have up to 3 sequences. By default, you'll see there is only 1. Acknowledge. So when the radio sends that telegram, should the other radio send back an acknowledge? Okay, and you can specify, yes, we want an acknowledgement back. Moving on to decoder definitions. Now, I'm skipping that multi-call. We'll come back to that now. Decoder definitions. Here we will specify what the radio should decode. So when the radio decodes a select 5 telegram, how many sequences are in there? And we can specify up to 3. Remember, if you specify 3, of course, these fields over here you'll see become ungrayed. They become white, so you can enter information in there. So the first thing that we have here is the numbers. Again, you can put here 0, 1, 3, 2, 4, 5, 6, up to 9, and A, B, C, D, E, F, of course. You can also put in variable digits, so A1 to A8, and so forth. Now, you'll see that below it here, there are a number of ticks. There's, in fact, 12 of them. So 12 relates to the number of digits that you can put in that sequence. So here you'll see the name. It's called Group Sequence 1. So here we specify what the radio should send. No, sorry, let me rewind. So underneath the decoder sequence, you will see that there is a number of tick boxes here. And we specify here what should the radio expect to see in that particular position there. So we're saying in position 2, 3, 4, and 5, it's ticked. So position 2, 3, 4, and 5 refers to position 2, 3, 4, and 5 up here. Now, what we are saying is, it's possible, let me say that again. What we are saying here is that in positions 2, 3, 4, and 5, it is possible that the radio will receive a group tone. It is possible that the radio will receive a group tone. So we can specify here what the radio should receive, and we can say, all right, in position 2 there might be a group tone, in position 3 there might be a group tone, in position 4 there might be a group tone, and the same for 5. If we don't put a tick there, then the radio will disregard any group tone in that position. So when the radio receives that, what should the radio do? We define that under decoder options 1 and 2. So the first thing is decoder type. What type of decoder is this? Is this for incoming emergency? Is it the priority call, stun, unstun? So we define what the radio should do when it receives that. Individual call alert. Should the radio sound an alert to say that there is a call coming in? Group call alert. If the radio receives a group call, what type of alert should it give? Should it give a group call alert? So if you have an individual call alert, you can specify what type of sound it should make. You can customize this. Call reminder alert, call reminder LED. So you can remind the user that a call was received, a selective call using select 5 was received. Decoder LED, when the radio decodes a selective call, the LED will shine orange saying that a call was received. Decoder options 2. So What else should the radio do? Well, it should start the auto reset timer. Yes. Do we want to have a call answer timer starting? Yes or no? should the radio enable a feature called callback? So let's say the radio rings and then it stops ringing because the call answer timer timed out. Do you want to give the user the ability to press the PTT and call whoever called them back? Okay, call back. Auto-acknowledge. Should the radio send back an auto-acknowledge when it receives that? Should the radio send a call forwarding acknowledge? So should the radio forward that selective call to another radio? Yes or no? Matching encode telegram, we will only use that with advanced selective calling, so you don't need to change that. Right, moving on. Last one here, auto acknowledge. Here we define if the radio sends an auto acknowledge, what telegram should it send as an auto acknowledge? Now, if we come back here to the decoder definitions, if you go to decoder options 2 and you tick auto acknowledge, you'll see that there it shows 1. That one there refers to that one there. So this one is that there, not that. So be very careful. That auto-acknowledge 1 refers to auto-acknowledge 1 here. And in here we specify what telegram we should send. Under what conditions should it send? Should it send when the channel is free and after a particular time? Channel free is quite good because if the channel is busy and someone tries to make a selective call, the receiving radio will receive the selective call, but it won't send an acknowledge because the channel is busy. Okay, so the call will fail. Right, we spoke about multi-call. Multi-call you will use if you're using, advanced selective calling. And here you define what is the minimum and maximum address that you can call on the radio. Now for most applications you'll probably not use this, but there are some specific applications that require this feature. Signaling system definitions. So here we define how the radio should send select 5. So there are different types of, let's say, subgroups or signaling standards within the select 5 bracket. So we have ZVI, we have CCIR, and we have two user-defined signaling systems. And those user-defined signaling systems we can define down here. By default, the radio uses ZVI1. Also by default, A and E are used for group and repeat. You can also specify in the encode and decode sequence two variable digits or quasi-variable digits called, one is called T1 and the other one is called T2. So if you specify T1 or you specify T2, you would define the frequencies of those tones over here. Then under user defined signaling system, we can specify those two signaling systems. DTMF, we can specify how the radio should send DTMF digits. Okay. So if you're going to use DTMF on your radio system, you would specify some settings here. So that there is the CPS. That is the Select 5 CPS. Now, it's not important that you understand every single field now. What is important is to watch and carefully learn from... The important thing is to watch and learn from the programming exercises which I will show you.